Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Municipal Budget Committee meeting. Tonight is a regular meeting, and it is June 16th, 2015. If everyone would rise, pledge allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, thank you for being here tonight. I know it's June, and typically in June, we don't even meet, but we are here. We have a lot of little stuff to run through tonight, so bear with me, and hopefully we'll get through it quickly. I'm going to start with everybody introducing themselves around the room, starting with Selectman Bean.
Good evening, Madam Chairman. Selectman Bean, the rep to your board. Thank you, ma'am.
Nicholas Bridle.
Scott Blair.
Mike Pierce.
Sonny Kravitz.
Dave Wood.
Brian Lopham.
Eileen Latimer Chair.
Jones.
Mike Plouffe.
Jim O'Loughlin.
Terry Zanoy here.
Glenn Farrell.
Thank you. All right. I'm just going to start out tonight with a quick review of correspondence that's hanging out there still. The request, one that was made of the town clerk to clarify the attrition for the Warren article that was passed, reducing this committee in number, has not been responded to yet. We still have time for that response, but I am going to send another message out for that. Now, also, as far as correspondence goes, I had corresponded to the town attorney to ask him the protocol, should we need funds for legal services. For those of you who were here a few years back, I think it's maybe 3 years back, we had funds in our budget for legal expenses, and we kind of struck a gentleman's agreement that we would help to reduce the budget by taking that money out of our budget and rely on outside council funds that are within the budget. So in other words, there was no need to actually just keep padding it for $2,000 at that point in time. If we needed it, we would then fall under outside council funds. I want to clarify something that some of you know, but some of you new people do not know, and that is in any situation where we need to be represented, and it's a question between us and the selectmen and on the same issue, that town council cannot represent us. He has to represent the select board. So that's where that request comes into play. I've listened to several meetings, and I think somewhere along the grapevine that's gotten twisted a little bit, that I was requesting funds. I have not requested any funds. What I have requested is the protocol, should we ever need to acquire funds for outside counsel. So far, everything I've done, the legal standpoint, has been free. But, you know, I might overstay my welcome in a few of these places, so I just wanted to know that should that happen, should we need the legal counsel, what the protocol would be. And since our selectman's rep is here, I understand, Mr. Bean, that went back to the board, and there is now a request that I send something to the chair himself.
Yeah, whatever your liaison was with Chairman Griffin, Madam Chair, is your affair. You're the chairman of this board, and he's the chairman of the select board.
I know who I am. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'm talking about the request, though, that was made for legal counsel. All right. Seeing no response, I will tell you, I'll generate another letter and ask. Nothing pressing right now, no need for funding, want to make that very clear. Just want to understand how and who we would go through and what form we would fill out should we need it. Okay. Attendance. We have some new people. I just want to clarify attendance. when you do not or cannot come to a meeting, you need to be excused, and that is done by contacting me. We do have, by the statutes, two forms of absences. One is excused, one is non-excused. If I don't get the email or call, then it's a non-excused absence. All right, it's not okay for Jerry to call Mike and tell him he's not coming tonight. All right, so please, if you cannot attend, just give me a call. All right, and participation. I count on all of you to participate fully on this committee. I know things come up that sometimes people can't and have other things planned. It's a long year. But for the most part, I found it a little bit disappointing that we had a meeting, that we had a guest, an invited guest, and five people could not make it. Also, five people were not excused. There were a couple of people that had two things going on at the same time, but I did get a note from someone who said they would choose to watch it from television at home. If that's your idea of serving on this committee, it's not really a good one. People voted for you, and you owe them participation. Thank you. Summer schedule. Before we get into a bunch of things, summer schedule, July and August are very difficult. The third week of July is going to hit, well, a lot of people are on vacation, so how does everybody feel about July and August? I'm going to throw that out for discussion. We typically have not met in July and August. I do know that we'll be talking about possibly committees and subcommittees meeting, but I'm talking about the formal third Tuesday of the month meeting here. So
I would prefer not to tell you the truth. I mean, I think we could, based on my limited knowledge of the budget cycle and what will the committee will be doing, I think that it can be pushed into September onward, and that I don't know as the July August would be productive.
Is that a motion?
Well, I thought it was discussion, but I don't
know.
It's
discussion.
Okay. I think we should meet according to the needs of the workload that we're undertaking. Yeah. So I think we ought to have a discussion of that workload rather than
so you
whether we should meet.
Shall I want to table this till the end of the discussion tonight?
Possibly makes more sense.
All right. You've got all your news open on the table, you know, until you see what direction they're going in.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, you know what, I'll put that down the bottom after we go through old business, new business, and everything else in between. All right, we're moving right along with this. Budget review. Did everybody go over their financials they received? All right.
Not yet.
Not yet?
Can I?
Absolutely.
Discussion? You know, this is as my first year, and so, you know, I approached it. I've got some financial background, and so, you know, I wanted to look and see how the town, you know, did with the 2014 budget. You know, just trying to get a history for it. You know, and we exceeded revenues by 18.3%, and we were 1% down in expenses. Now, what I did is I stripped out the debt, because any percentages I'm using, I took away the debt. So, I mean, I thought, gee, that's pretty good performance, you know. And then I looked to see how does the budget, the 2015 budget, compare to 2014. And we budgeted $727,000 less in revenue, $889,000 more in expenses. So said, that budget should be achievable, I thought, based on the results that we had the previous year. And then I looked at May, April, and then May, and again, stripping out that debt, I mean, we're, you know, our target was 41.7% of revenue for the 5 months. We were at 42.4%, so we're ahead of revenue. Our target expenses, 41.7, we're 38.8 without the debt, so we're well below. I think it's looking pretty good, and I would in my approach to what I look at the numbers for next year, I'd wonder if we had any personnel changes, if the same people are doing the same jobs, if they're preparing the budget for the second, third, or fourth year, you know, based on my history that I'm looking at, I'd have pretty good confidence in that they want to give us an achievable document. Mm-hmm. So that was my approach.
We haven't let the cat out of the bag, but Scott was a CFO before he retired.
Well, as a small hotel company, it was not just, you know.
But he's capable of, more than capable of looking at our spreadsheets. Was there anything that you went over? Because, you know, we get used to some things. Was there anything that you went over as a novice looking over this report for the first time, not as a novice in accounting, certainly, that jumped out or...
Well, I'm looking at, stripping out personal administration and insurance, which are two, that, you know, that's $6.4 million. If you take that out of our budget and then you take the debt out, 79% of the budget's in three areas. You know, it's kind of the 80-20 rule, I guess, you know, and it's, you know, public safety, highways, and municipal sanitation. You know, that you see the insignificance of animal control, I think, when you look at these numbers. So you know, that was, you know, one of the, I was trying to get a handle on, you know, where I should spend my time looking, you know. Mm-hmm. And those three departments kind of jump out at you as being significant. And I mean, there's some line items that are all kind of over the place. Snow removal was a big one. Hydrants, I didn't understand. I mean, that wasn't budgeted, or it's kind of a bust. But yeah. But they're, you know, it's like, again, it's not micromanaging. I think in total, it's a pretty good document, I think, that both the budget, mm-hmm, and how we're performing.
Remember, though, too, it's a default budget.
That's exactly
so
right.
It's not going to change from 2014.
This is not what was budgeted.
Yeah.
Voters voted down what, yeah, the town wanted in, yeah, the default budget. So within looking at the default budget, things look like they're in control as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah,
right.
It's our budget. You know, that's what we got to work with.
But that's why they won't change much from 2014, because it's a 2014 budget.
But what we should be seeing here is, if anything, any of the spending is not necessarily out of control, but let's say a victim of, mm-hmm, the default budget. All right? Any areas that we seem to have needed more that perhaps maybe wasn't identified last year, and I didn't see anything that jumped out.
As I recall, the deliberative session, I mentioned that, in my opinion, we had $250,000 more in many line items than what was requested. Mm-hmm. The default budget is going to take us to $250,000 more than what was requested from about 20, 30 line items. So, in my opinion, that we had some line items that were budgeted like for $15,000, and the default budget took it to 30 and 35 and 40.
Right.
So, I mean, and other line items, you know, if they just spend in accordance with their historics, we should be all right. I look at this, and then through April anyway, we're 30% of the budget spent, and we're about, if you annualize that comes out to be about 85-90% of the budget.
And everybody was mad at us because we looked at the bottom line of the budget.
Yeah.
Now, Mike has got May. I don't have May, so...
But I'm not... Well, because it was sent.
Christy notified everybody.
Okay. Does anybody not get it? You didn't get it.
I even picked it up. But,
All right. And you didn't get it, Glenn, so you're still off the... All right. I'll give you mine tonight before you leave.
Can I add a comment before we get off this subject about...
Yeah, no, I don't want to get off the subject. We're still going around.
Okay.
All right, but I think we're adopting the process by which everybody raises their hand instead of starting and putting everybody on the spot. Michael, go ahead.
No, I compared May's financial report with May of last year. And the interesting thing about it, which jumps out on page 1 of 3, is that the operating budget and expenses are 40.1%, okay? And if you look at last year's, it was 39.9%. That's a 0.2% difference, which boils down to nickels and dimes, about $50,000. So with all that snow removal and all this other crying wolf stuff, we're only $50,000 off, and at the end of the year, we usually have about $300,000 on unspent funds. So I see no need to even be anything but pleased about how it's gone so far. So far, absolutely.
Anyone else on?
Yeah, I had a couple of points. I noticed in the May numbers, the fuel costs are way up, and if it's a default budget, they should be way down. Because last year, price of fuel went way down, remember?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think, though, that we had an extremely cold winter, and on top of that, we had a lot of vehicles out on the road during...
Diesel fuel. Diesel.
Yeah, diesel fuel. And remember, we didn't touch the diesel fuel in the adjustments. We only touched gasoline.
Fred said that you have state contracts, so...
Yeah.
That's what I was just going to say. Wasn't there a state... Is it for more than 1 year?
Diesel fuel isn't a state contract.
Right. Yeah, we didn't... When we made adjustments, it was specifically on... We did not do anything on the heating, and we only touched the gasoline based on gasoline price.
I think we did touch the diesel.
Not the diesel.
No, the contract runs September, September. The other thing I noticed in the public works, nothing... showing in the line for repairs on the road. I'm talking patching. And they've been busy patching on Exeter Road for a month, and there's
good
zero
pick up
money.
On that, Sonny.
That's just a bookkeeping entry.
So I didn't pick up on that one.
Anyone else? Okay, I've got a few things here. It's something that I just want. I think this is going to be a theme for us this year. I think it's going to be one of the things that we ourselves should be looking at as goals, and the selectmen, I would ask that they look at it as a goal. The things that do pop out at me, and it's all through the thing, is overtime. We are, I think, horribly understaffed in a few areas, so I just want to call, I'm not going to go over every single line, but in general, pull out the overtime in each section, and you'll see that none of them are under, all of them are over, and some of them are over considerably. Now, I realize and I understand this was a difficult winter, but that's maybe where we need to concentrate and maybe ask some questions so that we can define what had to do with winter and the coverage there and what is just being absorbed normally, and perhaps look at funding some new positions via a Warren article, not through the budget. I'd like to just do a little bit of focus on that as we get into the departments. The other thing, and Sonny, you touched on it, and perhaps our selectman representative can answer some questions for us regarding Exeter Road. Mr. Bean, are you in the room?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Yeah. Town manager and the public works director currently in the execution phase of planning for that. As you know, the bid for that came in at $6 million. That was not accepted. We've got a new public works director, so that's on the front burner for this winter, or this summer, rather.
On the front burner, meaning do we have a company yet that's going to do that?
I don't have the particulars, nor am I prepared, nor was it on the agenda for this evening's discussion.
This is not an indictment, just an overview. I'm looking for the exact number, bear with me.
320.
I'm sorry?
320,000.
320?
It was to repay it.
Right.
The warrant. Should be in the warrant article.
Somewhere around 200,000 or something. GMI paving, wasn't it?
Yeah, I don't know. But looking at purely numbers, that's all I want to look at, okay? Not how we go about doing things. I would think when we put a warrant article out there and ask the voters for money, that we have a project as tight as it can possibly be in the moment that would be ready to, you know, we used the term shovel ready a while back, be able to go. And while I was happy to see the holes get filled on Exeter Road, I was equally unhappy at the fact that we were using DPW employees and resources and funds to do that as a Band-Aid, waiting for the Band-Aid. Because this $320,000 was only meant to be a Band-Aid until another point, 5 years possibly down the road, that we can really address the road. So, bottom line, I know we had issues, we had big potholes and that, but I was sitting here in June, and I honestly would have thought that that road would have been covered by now, and we would have been able to save the money that was spent in DPW patching it. So I guess I'm a little bit disappointed in that. Anybody else want to?
Yeah, Jerry. I thought I heard Fred, the town manager, and Phil, maybe you can help me on this, mentioned Belmont Paving or something.
Oh, GMI, Belmont, New Hampshire.
GMI.
Belmont, New Hampshire.
That's
came
it.
In at a came in
at a
very
low bid.
Came in at a very cost effective bid.
Yep.
And he kind of was excited.
Yep.
And I don't know what happened. I don't know what where we went beyond that. I like to see Exeter Road done too.
Could I ask Selectman Bean that, since we don't know the answers to that, could you follow through on that with town manager?
Sure, if you can give me a detailed list of information requisites, I'll be happy to answer each and
I'll generate that
to
you.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Okay, and I'll report it back to everybody here.
Thank you.
David?
Madam Chair, I was just thinking that when it comes to roads, to patch is a Band-Aid, and if you keep putting off the repair that needs to be done, the cost is going to go up tremendously.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that's outside of our realm,
mm-hmm.
but you know, to me, Exeter Road is one of the most populated roads in Hampton. It's one of the oldest roads in Hampton, and the thought of just putting Band-Aids on it just doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah, I'm not. Just so that, you know, I don't get myself in trouble with this and we're clear, I'm not questioning procedurally how they're going about doing. That's not part of what our relationship is with all of this. What I'm questioning is why we're spending money from DPW out of the budget to patch when we already voted for a patch that should have been initiated before now.
I believe the issue is that we put out a our bid to repave the existing road surface, that there were potholes that had developed in the interim as a consequence of the severe winter we had. You cannot repave over potholes. You have to fill them in first. So I believe that's the reason why DPW filled in those potholes in preparation of the repaving. I think it's just as simple as that.
It may be part of the question.
Does that make sense to you, Michael?
I don't think the plants open until May.
Yeah, they did a coal patch, though.
Hot top plants,
mm-hmm.
for resurfacing roads. So they wouldn't. They had to repair it from the time the frost started to come out in March until into May, just to keep what was there and not let the potholes get out of control,
mm-hmm.
which they did, and they've done that. But the paving contract went out, I think, in April, and the proposals were back in May. And I thought that the contract was all set and it was ready to go. And I'm a little perplexed as to why it's still sitting.
Okay. Sure.
I may comment. It may be that there's some consolidation planning here. Because we talked about the corner of High Street and one. You know, the flooding down there and the correcting of that, and then the repaving of that, perhaps. And also those three streets over on the north side of Hannaford in the back there.
Ruth Belmont.
Yeah, Ruth. Yeah. It could be if we consolidate two or three of these projects, you get economies of scale and savings. Yeah. That might be what's going on. I don't know.
I guess the question...
Maybe what's going on, because the Warren article was explicit about Exeter Road. So that money can only be spent on Exeter Road. No consolidation opportunities are there.
No, I hear what Jerry's saying, Tim. He's saying if you put multiple projects together, they're funded separately.
Yeah.
But you may get a break on the
coming
total
under.
Thing by giving it to one.
Yeah.
And it's possible. I guess we don't have to give this thing a life.
Solid
the question is, I want to make sure we're not spending money we didn't have to spend.
The pothole filling was not spending money we didn't have to spend. That's clear. So that's not an issue at all.
The only
question that appears is, when's it going to happen? And I believe it's going to be happening soon, based on what I've heard at the various selectmen meetings over time. They're trying to coordinate it so that the traffic implications are minimal. As I recall, there was also some discussion about doing perhaps it at night as well, but I'm not sure if that was final or not.
The night stuff, I think.
But they're timing it with the seasonal traffic flow at this point.
Was the High Street side.
Oh, for the nighttime?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think the exit road was regular.
It's going to be one side and then the other.
Yeah, daytime work.
I know the main complicating factor is timing it so that it has minimum impact on seasonal traffic flow.
Right.
But the contract's already been, you know, both sides have agreed to the contract.
Okay. Satisfied with that one. Anything else in the financials?
Can I,
Sure, Jim.
Nothing to do with paving.
Thank you.
going back a few comments ago, when we're talking about where we are percentage-wise into the default budget, it seems to me that, again, I'm a novice on this board, but mm-hmm. I'm a little confused with, we're looking at the budget that was passed, ultimately, which is a default budget.
It's the default.
So I think by looking at this and we're saying, well, see, they're doing a good job because they're right where we're supposed to be and that, you know, so they didn't need the extra and that. That's not the message I get out of this. The message I get out of this is that we have professionals who are running their departments. Mm-hmm. They've been given a budget and they're doing their job to stay within that budget. Mm-hmm. But I don't think the message should be, see, they didn't need what they were asking for. I think the message is they're doing what they have to do because they're professionals, mm-hmm. and they're going to stay within the default budget. But I don't think we should cloud those issues. I think the people that came in here who asked for what they asked for, I think that's what they need to run their departments. Now, that's not to say that they're not going to run them with less because that's what they have. But it may not be the best way to run the departments.
Well, they did have almost $800,000 more than they did the year before. All I was saying is I was looking at the places that have these little spikes because it's indicative of perhaps them not being able to live with what they had. That's what I'm talking about.
Except their job is they're charged to live within their budget.
That's right.
And they're doing that.
Mm-hmm.
Except they can move the numbers around within their budget. Now, if you look on page 10 out of the main numbers, paving and reconstruction, zero money spent. And, you know, there should be they've been working on Exeter Road, there should be a number there.
I agree with that. But I'm just saying overall, I think I'm hearing a message being sent that, see, they're living within that budget that they were given. Well, of course they are, because that's their job.
Yeah.
But I don't think it should take away from what their request was. That's all I'm saying.
Thank you.
Okay.
That'd be a good question for Paul. What didn't you get?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think that was brought up at Monday's selectmen's meetings, is that they were charging the heads to do exactly that. They right. wanted a report of what couldn't we get to because mm-hmm. of the default budget. Just so they'll have some ammunition to...
I don't think that Phil had enough time to get that information, because today's Tuesday and...
Oh, no, I didn't mean for us, for themselves.
Right.
I mean, we've had, since the year 2000, we've lived with more default budgets than mm-hmm. we've lived with budgets. So that's been living within our means and like I say, this budget was almost $800,000 more than the year before. So it wasn't apples for apples. It had a huge increase in it over the previous year. And I think that's what our job is to look and see what isn't making the grade, what does need to be enhanced, but then how we're going to deal with it. Are we going to look to put it in the budget, or are we going to look to put it in a warrant article? And it seems to me the voters passed the warrant articles that they wanted and that they needed last year. I was very surprised even with the road ones, even though everybody here was unanimous about that's what we needed. You didn't know if the voters would go for it, and they did. So I think we have to trust the fact, too, that people know what they want, know what they need, and we shouldn't be afraid of putting some of these things on a warrant article and keep them out of the budget. All right.
Madam Chair, real quick.
Yes.
But does that mean if, like, a department has any sort of request for a new item that they should automatically think, I'm not even going to put it in my budget, try to shoot for a warrant article instead because the default budget is what I'm going to get dealt with? I mean, like...
No, they try.
No.
I mean, and then sometimes, half the time, Fred shoots it down.
Yeah.
Before it even gets...
But I mean...
We call it double dipping.
I agree with your point. You know, if the cops don't get new weapons, you give them stones, they're going to go out there and police the streets. They're going to make do with what they have to do because that's the job they have to do. But if they needed new guns, do they go, I don't even want to put it in my budget because I don't want that to get shot down. So should we just shoot it for a warrant article?
Yeah. Historically, there is a budget for new equipment already there. All right. I'll give you a good, for instance, there is money in the budget for the specials in the police department.
Mm-hmm.
And this year, we wanted a second round. People in this town acknowledge the fact that our police force does need some enhancement. We do need to build it. And that second round went out as a warrant article, and it passed.
Mm-hmm.
All right? So my answer to you, Nick, is it's not a one-size-fits-all. We have a lot of places within the budget that we maintain. We've been a very logical community as we've gone along.
Mm-hmm.
But now we're growing, and there are other things that we need, and maybe a different look at the roads and how we deal with roads. And I'll talk about that a little bit later.
Yeah.
Not to get too far from
yeah.
this. But no, the thing is to look at what do we have in there? And what is the request? And if it's so much more, maybe, than what's already there, then maybe it needs to be in a warrant article. And if we really need it, I really believe the voters will give it to you.
Okay.
All right? And that's, so, yeah.
I just get nervous if I was leading a department and it was up to me to say, well, is this, you constantly having to triage things, necessities or what's more important than the other, and having to say, well, we don't need new radios today because we need this more. We need more staff, or we need new this. I want to make sure that we keep, my main goal is to make sure that we keep the training fresh, the bodies fresh, if it's more bodies that are needed, whether it's the DPW, the police, or fire department. Make sure everybody isn't afraid to come forward to ask for that stuff, you know, because I want to make sure that they don't just have to default, say, well, let's put it on a warrant article because we're afraid to put it in our expense budget.
I don't want anybody to be afraid of anything.
Yeah.
In the end, it may not be the what they're asking for, but how we ask the voters for it, okay?
Understood.
I think that part of the process, people in this town want to say on what they decide on, what they don't decide on. But I don't think that any department head should be afraid. That's what we want them to do, is come in and tell us. I've said it more than once.
Mm-hmm.
You know, come in and tell us what you need. And I don't want to tie their hands. That's not what the budget process is about. It's just how we go about attaining the things that we do need.
Okay.
Tim was next, and then Sonny.
Yeah, I think Nick brings up a good point. I think that is a commonly held view, but I think we need to take the greater truth at hand here, that department heads do not create warrant articles.
Mm-hmm.
So they're not sitting there saying, should I make a warrant article or put it in the budget? That's not their decision. They may end up having an advocacy toward doing one or the other, but it's not their decision.
I understand it's not their decision. I'm just...
You know, I want to make clear for everyone, including the TV audience,
yeah,
that it's the Board of Selectmen that make that decision. Okay? As a practical matter, it's the town manager, because the Board of Selectmen does whatever the town manager wants, essentially. So it's really the town manager, who is in fact the boss of all those department heads.
I understand.
So that's really where the call is made, is in the town manager's office.
Yeah, and I understand. I think my point was more in the department heads making that having that internal monologue where what battle is worth fighting for, you know what I'm saying, and triaging the needs of the department, mm-hmm. and going forward to say what's the best route to go about this. Again, they're doing a wonderful job with the amount of stuff they have, and I'm sure they will continue to do so. And I just want to make sure that you know, we're working together with, say it's the Board of Selectmen, the department heads. I want to make sure that we're trying to do our best so that our department heads can kind of, like you said, feel comfortable coming here and saying, hey, we need, you know, new cars, or we need new this. I want them to, you know, be able to feel like they can come to us and not be, for lack of better terms, browbeat or burdened with having to come up with validating over validating the needs of the department. Working within the budget, you know, the default budget, they're doing a great job, but I don't want to have them triage one thing that's over the other one. Not saying that they would create a warrant article, but go through the efforts of what's worth fighting for as far as their needs and equipment and training and such.
Well, they're coming in just simply telling us what they, not telling us, but they're telling the town manager, their boss, and the town manager is communicating that to the Board of Selectmen. Whatever he communicates, the Board of Selectmen basically throws holy water on it, and it comes down to us, okay? Mm-hmm. And basically, we have a discussion about their needs, mm-hmm. and how these numbers relate to those needs, whether it's in the form of the budget or whether it's in the form of a warrant article.
Okay.
I think that it does make some sense, as Eileen, the chairman, pointed out, that it's not a black and white issue whether it belongs in the budget or a separate warrant article.
Mm-hmm.
I think those situations need to be separate. And I think a good example of that was the police department last year. It was a new process for training new officers.
Yeah.
And there was more money needed for that. Now, it was a good question about whether that should go in the budget or not. Well, it was a new process. You know, from my mind, it made perfect sense for a new process to be put forth to the voters and make the case. The case was made. The voters overwhelmingly approved it. No issue at all. Had that been put in the budget, that new process would have been dead. And that would not have been good,
mm-hmm.
because that's not what the voters apparently wanted.
Okay.
So, you know, warrant articles are very good for these kind of things.
Okay.
Jerry?
Yeah, I feel that operating expenses are, there's a big difference between operating expenses and capital items. And I think operating expenses, when they come in here and they explain their line items, if there's an increase in the line item, it's sufficiently backed up in their backup data. Its backup data is not missing or is inadequate. And they adequately describe why the increase took place. I'm okay. It's when an adequate rationale is not displayed and the backup information is not there or if totally inadequate. That's where I'm in favor of reduction.
Mm-hmm.
So it's on how that budget is prepared and reviewed before it comes in here.
And that really relates to visibility that we've brought so many times up in the past. And a perfect example of that was one department having this radio maintenance account. Remember that?
Yep.
And they acknowledge they don't have any radios, but they're funding lawn care and all kinds of other stuff in this radio maintenance account.
Mm-hmm.
This lacks visibility. All right, and that's the kind of thing we need, and what Jerry's calling for when he says background, I think it's basically visibility. Once things are visible, they're likely to be approved. But when they're not, that becomes a problem for a number of people.
Nick, one thing that we have to remember, and I'm going to throw this out, not as a buzzkill, but because it's reality, is there is only so much money
mm-hmm.
that this town is going to give you.
Yeah.
Voters are going to give you. Last year felt like it was a little bit of a whiplash, but quite honestly, they wouldn't give us $300,000 the year before.
Mm-hmm.
So looking at $2 million, it wasn't going to happen. And you have to keep that in the back of your mind. Yes, we can substantiate everything line by line by line and say, yeah, that's great, we'd like to have it, but will they give it to us? No, and that's one opportunity that you have mm-hmm. with a warrant article. And you know, when you have a warrant article, you got to sell it. And as an example, I'll tell you both pond issues that none of us started last year with in the front of our brain, but you know what? There was a hard sell and a hard push, and the people that want them got them. So you kind of have to look at it that way, too. And, you know, going back, because of the way last year happened, and we came in on more of a severe note than we had a couple for a few years, we're looked at one way in this group. But you know what? There's people sitting here at this table right now that goes back, you weren't here, I don't think, goes back to the fireboat that the fire department needed because they were going out there in a little rubber tub.
I mean, the Navy.
We were sitting here saying, well, the Coast Guard will be here. Let me tell you, that was one hard-fought battle that the fire department got because the members on this budget committee did battle. We yelled, screamed, and hollered back and forth on this floor. So we can do that, too.
Yeah.
And probably, you know, the biggest thing, like you're opening that door, and I think by asking that question, you don't know that part of us yet that says, please, bring it to the table. We can't judge it unless you educate us. And you've led me to a position that I'm going to take the opportunity of right now. We seem to have a problem with asking the Board of Selectmen, or needing to ask the Board of Selectmen to have department heads come in. The value of having department heads come in, the value of having our members work, even on subcommittees sometimes, with those department heads, is that they educate us and we advocate those needs. That happens more often than the opposite scenario of us spending time and us taking their heads off. The more information that we have, SAU 90 was a case in point. The more time we spent with SAU 21, the more convinced we were that we would get a better bang for our dollar, all right, by forming our own SAU 90. And that has proven itself, and they come in with a great budget and they adhere to it. So some of the fallacies here and some of the things that people think will happen by getting together and exchanging this information actually works historically to just the opposite effect. So I'm sorry to throw that commercial in there, but you gave me the opportunity and I wanted to show we have a value for listening to that. Okay. Sonny?
Yeah, what Nick, I think, was talking about is a capital improvement program, the CIP. If a department has a need that they want to have addressed, they put it in the CIP.
The CIP is a plan, but we don't fund it, and well, that's inherently
that's,
the problem.
That's part of the problem.
That's part of the problem. We don't fund the CIP, so we come up with the plan, and it's only if...
And then the numbers don't add up anyway. So.
Jerry?
Yeah, I mean, perfect example, what Tim brought up was radio maintenance. I'm looking at winter sand. I asked last year, there was money budgeted.
You wouldn't winter
nothing
sand.
Spent. Here it is. We budgeted $13,877 this year.
Jerry likes the pound.
Zero spent on sand. Where is that money being spent on?
Well,
I know we're buying it. Where was it? I know we're buying sand. I see it all over the roads.
You know what? If you guys have questions on particular items from this point on, because now we're getting into the budget. It will do like last year. If you have a question on a particular line in the budget, send it to me, and I'll send it along in a group once a month for the next meeting to finance and department heads get some answers like we did last year. I can't give you one on that one.
I think the issue Jerry was raising was the issue of accounting visibility.
I get it.
It wasn't raising the question about whether the money's spent or why it isn't spent. The question was about accounting visibility, which keeps coming up. And as Selectman Bean said 2 months ago when he gave us his little speech on process, we're not going to be allowed to get into accounting visibility. We must remain blind to accounts.
Well, I would interject into that. If there is, this would seem logical to me.
It isn't.
If we have a question on a line, we should ask the question, get an answer. If you don't get an answer, you have the right to vote accordingly.
It's not about questions. It's about whether or not the accounts are descriptive in terms of how the money is taken from there for expenditures. That's what it is all about. Mm-hmm. It's not about you know, we wouldn't have so many questions if the accounts were descriptive as to what they were being used for.
Well, let's try the route where if there's a specific question, well, we're still early on in the budget, because I'd rather ask them now than when we get into each department, then forward them to me, and let's see if we can get a little bit more visibility here. Fair enough?
No, I can't hear.
All right. I'm going to move on to the reports. And school district, Jerry. And budget impact only.
Yeah. We're right current through May. Through May, we're running a $346,574 variance, positive variance, underspent. 82% of that is a result of employee benefits. That is to say, since we're budgeting a year and a half out, we take percentages given to us by the state, and they're usually on the high side. So 82% of that variance came out of health insurance expense. District-wide was $197,000 underspent. So what we went with, what they told us, 197, 197 out of the 283. So that's 70% of the total overrun in the or underrun in the employee benefits area. In total, again, we're $346,574 under the budget. But if you take out these employee benefits that we had to use certain percentages from that the state gave us when we budgeted in the fall of 2014, if you will, what I'm saying is we're going to be budgeting now for 16-17. We're way out there in terms of budgeting. They give us a percentage, and it's usually lower. And that's where we get this big variance.
But now, are you 346,574 under as of
end of May?
May.
Right.
So you still have one more month.
Right.
And yet, almost 200,000 of that was unanticipated because of misleading, if you will.
Right on.
Wrong term.
So you know, so if you take out that
misleading, what?
Well, the percentage is given to us by the state
right.
for health insurance.
You give them
if you take out that employee benefit amount.
Right,
you're left with $62,000,
yes, so
which
like
gives you a budget accuracy of 99.66%.
Yeah.
Wow, that's pretty close.
Well, yeah, that's what I was going to say. You're
right
there.
It's excellent.
When school always does a good job.
Oh, they do. Because, I mean, even when they come before the school board, and we go over every line, which I do here for the town, they come in on the conservative and prudent side. Between Nate and
Nathan's wonderful.
And Kathy Murphy, they're coming in as prudent and conservative. And I have a hard time squeezing money out of there.
I know.
I'm lucky if I get 30,000, 40,000 out of there.
Jerry, when schools are closed due to inclement weather, those days are made up subsequently.
Well, they're given, there's also a certain amount of
but
days.
But there's also utility costs that still take place while the school's closed. And again, when the school's days are made up and all that sort of stuff. Is there some sense of what the cost is for a school day closure? But it does exist. There is a cost.
There is a cost. I mean, you know, you have, well, I mean, it's there. It's budgeted as being open. You got to keep your heat up. The lights may not be burning as bright. And your teachers are being paid, you know. I mean, there's almost like a fixed cost, you know.
Jerry, is there something built into the contracts that when you have a snow day, the teachers are paid regardless? Or do they take that as a personal day, or do you know?
Well, right now, I think the state requires 180 days. Our contracts are calling for like 183 or 104, 184. So the absolute state requirement is 180. Our teachers are signed up, I believe, by contract for 183 or 184, something like that.
So it usually balances out.
It balances out. There isn't any mismatch there. I mean, but relatively speaking, not significant.
Okay.
Well, I mean, it's deadly accurate when you take out the employee benefits.
Wow.
Yeah.
Deadly accurate.
Impressive.
I'd like to clone Nathan Lunny.
Yes, I agree.
Yeah. Mm. It's excellent.
I mean, he just negotiated some contracts with the gas and electric that, in the face of rising costs, were significant. That will go into...
Now, does he work with the Energy Committee, with the town? No.
I don't think so.
Do we still have, Selectman Bean, do we still have the Energy Commission?
We do, yes.
We do.
They're on TV.
Yeah, it might not be a bad idea if he shared some of his expertise. We'd be, probably be happy to do that. thank you, Jerry. That's good news.
Yeah.
All right, we don't have, you're not representing the precinct tonight.
All I did was, I did give everybody the numbers up to date for the Phil's district.
Okay, yeah. Next time. Selectman Bean.
Yes, ma'am.
And Selectman's report on those things impacting budget only.
Director Pulliam has published the income expense statements on June 11th for your edification and review.
Yeah, we've had that. We don't have to read through that.
That's my report.
We just went over that.
Can we ask a question, Madam Chair?
Well, I was going to see if Selectman Bean had anything else.
No, ma'am.
Other than the report, so that's what you're entering in is...
Yes, ma'am.
Is the report itself. Okay. Question, Michael?
Yeah, at your last night's meeting, it appears that the Selectmen have decided that voted 4-1 to take 352,000, give or take, out of the designated fund balance. And I was just curious what the thinking was for that based on this May report.
That question is directed to Mr. Bean?
Yes.
Yes.
And pardon me, what is the question?
Last night at your meeting, you had approved taking out 352,000 out of the unexpended fund balance, undesignated fund balance, I mean. And I was just wondering what your thinking was or your logic behind that in view of this May report.
Well, the fact of the matter is that there were substantial costs associated with the storm. There is a requirement to ask or petition the DRA for that authority to do so and to make up any of those shortfalls. It came before the board last night. There was a 4-1 vote. Is that so?
Well, when we were looking at this, when we were talking about this May report a few minutes ago, it comes down to where you're 2.2% above last year's percentage of the budgets being spent. That's a roughly $50,000. So I'm just wondering how you can justify 352 when you're only over by 50,000. And that is, question is directed to you, Selectman Bean.
Yeah, I've already answered your question, Mr. Pierce.
You have? Can you repeat your answer again? I must have missed it.
No, I can't.
Madam Chairman, I think that this is not working too well, and I'm going to make a motion that we contact the DRA immediately and suggest and recommend they do not approve the 352 withdrawal from the undesignated fund balance.
Okay,
I'll second that.
Jerry, second? All right. Going to lead out the discussion on this one.
Okay.
Before we go that route, I'm just going to interject this. There's too many unknowns on this. As you know, our year is lopsided on expenses. So usually when we get to this time of the year, right, Mike? And you know this, Jerry, and you know this, Michael. Usually when we get to this time of the year, even though we could be at 41%, a lot of times we're not, because our heavy spending is in the summer. So that's why it's important to me to break down, like I was talking before, what money we've spent in certain areas so that we can look at that to better assess where we are now. Now, first of all, this was, I'm in an industry that keeps track of this stuff. This was the worst winter on record. It wasn't one of the worst, it was the worst winter on record. And we did have some very big expenses attached to it. Having said that, if it was a very expensive year, we spent years putting money in for a rainy day, all right, and building up $5 million for the times when we needed to use it. And if the worst winter on record isn't one of those times, I don't know what is. All right. That's part of me saying that. The problem that I have with the rest of it is that I don't believe there was any itemization given last night. Mr. Bean, was there an itemization for this 352,000? It came down to 352,000 something and 18 cents. So I'm assuming that it wasn't a rough number, it was an exact number compiled from a list.
It was, and I don't know if folks had a chance to read that, but it was a comparison and contrast between prior years that were quote normal and then years that weren't. I would just draw attention to Director Pulliam's 11 June report on pages 10 and 11. Highway and streets is over target at basically 60% spent. This is primarily due to snow and ice removal costs, which are currently at 305%.
I don't know, because on that I'm not sure. Was any part of that money, the money spent to surface and fix the potholes on Exeter Road?
I don't have the breakdown on that, Madam Chair.
Well, that's what I'm talking about, is that I think before we can start picking things apart, it would be nice to have a breakdown of what that 352,000 plus was made up of.
Yes, ma'am.
The other thing, too, though, wasn't this tied in some way to where the president did declare an emergency, and we were going to get reimbursed
for the first storm.
For one of the three. Mm-hmm.
And wasn't somehow something like we were going to rate Peter to pay Paul type
of
thing?
The next question would be, knowing that one of the storms was declared and would be covered, do we know how much coverage that dollar amount is that we asked for that storm, or what we can anticipate getting?
No, ma'am. And yeah, those are good questions. And if you just either email the town manager, whatever communication platform you want to use, and he can give you that breakdown, you can get it to your committee.
Yeah. Madam Chair?
Yes.
May I suggest that what we're talking about here should be addressed to the town manager, not the Board of Selectmen. We should address that directly with the town manager.
No, that's not what
know,
the selectmen decided.
Typically, that's why we have a selectman's rep on this committee, so that we don't have to go and schedule an appointment. We can ask these questions of the selectman's representative, and the selectman's representative can then go back to his board and liaison the questions. I mean, if it has to be done in writing, I'll take it on and do it in writing, but I want people to know that is the reason why we have three representatives on this committee. They actually do have a function, and that is to liaison between the committees. Now, if they've chosen not to do it, we'll do our job anyway this year. But Michael, you've been in that position. Jerry, you've been in that position, and correct me if I'm wrong.
The point I'd like to make is the Budget Committee is an elected board just like the Board of Selectmen. We're not answerable to the Board of Selectmen. We're an independent body.
Well, yes, we realize that, and we had the seminar last time, Sonny, and thank you for bringing it up. That is the case. What we're trying to do here is to actually find a way to work with one another.
I understand that.
And these are valid questions with the budget, all right? This is money that, a lot of the money that went into this fund that we're going to take the money out of, for those of you who were not on the committee at that point in time, came from taking it from the roads and taking it from these other areas that now we're having a hard time with. We took $1 million out of it last year to reduce the tax rate. Now we're looking to take another $352,000. We're getting a little bit too free with this money that was so hard to come by to put into the account. If we spent it, like I said when I started this whole thing, all right, we put that money away for a rainy day, the worst winter ever, okay, certainly qualifies for maybe bringing that in, especially in a year that we had a default budget. But what I want to substantiate or see substantiated, did we spend 352, or we just, you said, Selectman Bean, these are percentages. I think what we'd like to see is an actual accounting that makes up this 362. That would give me a better comfort zone. And also, how much is anticipated of that money to come back? I believe we get 35% back from one storm, but that may possibly have been the most expensive storm. So I don't know what that dollar amount is. And if that, in fact, is coming back to us, wouldn't that come out of the 352 if the 352 was actual expenses? So you would have your actual expenses and then what you anticipate getting back from the government, and then that perhaps should be the bottom line of what you're looking to take out for funds, not just this number of 352, which I don't see substantiated. Anybody want to comment on that one?
Yeah.
Jerry?
I'm just looking for rationale.
Yeah, me too.
And I don't want to think of this as whimsical. I want to think of this. Some rationale thinking went on, some analytical thinking went on. Through April, this Department of Public Works budget was 34% spent only through April. I don't know what it is now, Mike. I don't have May. It didn't seem like we were wobbling and going out of orbit. You're right. I heard that we were supposed to be covered 100% by the first storm. I didn't hear about third. The other two storms, we had to bear full cost for, I understand. But I want to hear something.
Yeah,
that's the point. I'm looking for rationale, not whimsical sweeps with no analysis.
Now you have a motion out here. Are you content to withdraw the motion? Could I ask you to withdraw the motion?
I just like to make a comment before I consider that request. If I could, okay. Madam Chairman, here we just went through looking at and discussing the May results, and we found that we're here roughly $50,000 more than we were last year. If you look at that by itself, there's no way you can possibly justify 352. And with Mr. Bean's response to our questions tonight, it's still very difficult for us to see how we can justify taking that huge chunk of change out and giving him $300,000 plus just to play with in the budget. That was the way I looked at. I could be wrong. That's the way it appears, okay? So my problem with all that is they approved this withdrawal last night. That means tomorrow, maybe today, the request is probably already on the table of the DRA asking for permission to do it. And if they say yes, it's a done deal. So by the time Mr. Bean gets back to us with an explanation, if he ever does, about what this money is spent for, it's going to be too late. So I think we've either got to decide we're going to push it right now with this expediency, or we might as well just forget about it. That's my feeling about it, because it's probably already, they probably got the request today. And if we want them to consider not recommending, we have to get a message up to them right away, or it's out already off the table.
I agree with you, Mike.
I mean, I hate to say that this is an emergency, but it's sort of like when you look at the expenditure in emergency, unexpected emergency and sudden, everybody knew we get snow in the wintertime. Everybody knows that. That's not sudden. That's not an unexpected emergency. The only way you can twist that is the amount of snow we got. Okay? And that's just part of living in New England. You said it's the worst we've ever had. I had less snow piled up in my driveway this year than about 10 years ago. In fact, you had your front end loader come remove it by my driveway. So that was an accumulation of several storms rather than like we had this year. I'm not trying to compare anything. I'm just saying we get snow in the wintertime. Sometimes it's more than we want. But I think if we're going to act on this, we need to act on it with expediency. Otherwise, we're just blowing smoke, and if there's somebody going to take their time or not give us the answers we want about the 352? Just wasting everybody's time.
I just need some more information.
Madam Chair, as a practical matter, tabling this motion, given the time emergency that has been imposed on us by the town manager, tabling it is effectively killing it. Because as Mr. Pierce said,
I listen to the
time
argument.
Is of the essence here.
And I agree.
Okay, so
I agree.
Let's not table it.
So
let's man up and vote on it, or discuss it and vote on it.
All right, discussion. continues. Glenn?
It may be as simple as that they don't pay it, they haven't paid the bill. I know that there's POs open throughout the year to take care of their, not only their plowing contracts, they just might have paid the bills, which is why...
Our manager last night said he paid the bills.
Oh, okay. Because I know he was keeping track of every invoice for the...
It was clear that he had already paid the bills.
Oh, okay. Then maybe Christie has not paid the...
Pardon?
The private contractors.
He didn't specify. What he did say is Mary Louise objected, saying that the budget committee, according to 32:11, subitem Roman I, specifies that needs to have budget committee majority approval for the request to go to the DRA. And the town manager pointed out Roman numeral 2, which is an exemption to Roman numeral I, which says not if the money is already expended.
Oh, okay.
And therefore, the money was already expended, therefore he's claiming that exemption, even though Roman number 2 actually specifies if it's a sudden and unexpected. Now, it's not sudden and unexpected to me when you've already paid the bill, and it's now 3 or 4 months after the fact. I mean, if it's an emergency, you react immediately. You don't react 3 or 4 months later.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that doesn't seem to wash with me from a legal point of view.
No, that answers my question.
I think the problem I'm having with it, too, is that I'm not seeing a crisis yet in the budget. We still have a balance of $16 million.
Oh, I know.
So I'm not seeing us at a crisis point, as the percentage that you pointed out, Mike. If we were in maybe October and November looking at a shortfall for the end of the year, I think I'd feel better about it, and I don't think I'm going to feel better about it unless I see an itemization of where it came from to begin with. But
if I may,
anybody, well, before we go to you again, anybody else on this side? All right, Mike.
No, I was just going to say, Mary Louise brought this up last night. Why don't we put it off until later in the season, like October and November time frame? Then you'd have a better picture of what the finances are.
Right.
I mean, you suggested that you get busy in the summer with spending, which we do. We spend a lot of money in the summertime. No argument with
it's
that.
It's disproportionate logic. In the summer.
Oh, yeah. It's probably almost half again as much as it is the rest of the time, maybe twice as much. But you wouldn't be looking at this necessity at this point because you still have a lot of money to carry you forward, maybe not enough to make it to the end of the year. And then by the time you get to October, though, or to November, now you can really fine-tune it and see what you have to make it. Because they always come in and say, well, right now, Mike used to come in and say, right now we have an estimated surplus. That's the wrong word. I don't like that word. We're going to have unspended funds of about $200,000 or $300,000. And as we got closer, he could get it more accurate, you know, almost by the day. So I think it's smart, would have been smart, in hindsight, to wait till later. But we weren't. This committee was not given that choice, so we're between a rock and a hard place. Either we're going to think about it and do something, or we're just going to let it slide by and say, "Well, let's see. There's another 300,000. There's another 400,000. There's a couple of million. Give us another budget that's really 2 or 3 million bigger than last year's." I mean, it just can go on and on and on. So I'm saying, the budget committee's responsibility is to take a good look at this and see what you want to do. I mean, I always supported the taxpayers, and I still do, and I will until my last breath.
Scott, did I see you?
Yeah,
and then Glenn.
I did watch a good piece of the meeting last night. I wish I had paid more attention to it now, you know, there was a lot of discussion on this point. I mean, it wasn't an easy vote for them. So there was a lot of give and take, and the fellow that was talking, and I don't know what his role was, whether that was the town manager, but he was saying, look, here's my issue, you know, I can address it, but the overrun, but I'm going to have to close the transfer station for a few days, I'm going to have to do this and that. He talked about, you know, adjusting his expense levels. Now, you know, there didn't seem to be a willingness to cross departments at that point, you know, or... you know, take it out of the police department or take the excess out of the fire department. So I don't know the process, but I know that the process of the selectmen deciding this was a pretty extensive discussion. Now, it seems like they've come down on a on something that, you know, we'd rather have them look at their entire budget and let's try to live within that bottom line number. And if you can't in September, October, there's still plenty of time
right.
to take that 300,000. If that's our, you know, collective point of view, I don't know why it would be at odds with the selectmen. I mean, it seems though they would have the same goal, you know. It seems like an easy answer to just wait until September or October.
I agree.
Yeah, you can
now move. Let me ask Selectman Bean, is there anything from a time constraint on this money being requested now that it would not we would not be able to ask for it under the same criteria in September or October?
September, October. That was not discussed last night, and I will incorporate that into one of your information requests.
Okay. We're not. I don't think anybody here is saying no if we need it. It just seems premature at this point in time. Jim?
Just a question on procedure. I'm not. There was a motion made and seconded, and then I thought you said we weren't going to discuss it.
We are, though.
No, we are discussing it.
But so now we are discussing.
Yes, we are discussing.
Okay, yeah. All right. Well, yeah. Because we started talking, we said we're not going to discuss it, but here we are.
No, there was a motion made.
Okay,
and
so the motion's on the floor.
Then we looked to see if we would back off that motion, but time being of the essence in this situation, I was trying to ask Mike if he would withdraw it while we asked the questions, but it's going so quickly from where it set out from the selectmen's end
okay,
last night that it's now back on the table.
I just want to know where we are on the, okay,
that's
so.
Where we are. So I'm going to acknowledge you, then Tim and Glenn, and then we'll go back on this side.
Okay.
I think we need a good discussion on this issue.
Okay. Then if we're going to vote on this, I don't have any information in front of me to vote on. And
nobody does.
Jim. Well, I know, and it doesn't put us in a good position, and I don't know why, and I don't even want an answer to my question, but I don't know why we seem to be at an adversarial position here, and because I think the loser is going to be the town,
mm-hmm.
if it continues down a road of being in an adversarial position. I think the end result, we should all be looking for the same end result. I don't care what board we're talking about. It doesn't seem that that's what's going on. I don't know, and I'm on the outside of this, and that's where I want to stay right now, on the outside of this, because I don't want to get involved in the minutiae of any type of turf war. But not having the information, and I get what everyone's saying, I'm probably going to have to vote against the motion because I'm probably going to have to put, for this time, I'm probably going to have to put my confidence with the town manager and the board of selectmen that what they're doing is the right decision. That's who our elected official is, and our elected official has appointed the town manager to run the town. But the caveat with that, and not that anyone would care about it, this is it, as far as I'm concerned. This will be the last time I do that if I see a continuation of an adversarial position, because at that point, it's going to be, the message to me is going to be, this is how it's going to be. So then I'm just going to have to say, well, then you know what? We'll just take the position that we're going to have to do what we have to do. But at this point, I think I'd have to side with the manager and the selectman, and hopefully something can thaw this craziness that seems to be going on. So that's all I have to say about that.
Tim? And Glenn?
I could just offer again on page.
Excuse me, point of order, Madam Chair.
Yeah, no, I'll do after that.
It's clear that the town manager has already paid these bills. No one is disputing that, right? So we can have confidence the bills have been paid. He found the money somewhere to pay them.
I don't know any of that.
No, he couldn't have paid them if he didn't find the money to pay them with. I mean, it's the same with your own checking account.
I don't know if they paid.
Took it out of the operating budget.
Whatever, he found the money, so he paid them. He paid them because he could find the money.
Right.
I was prepared during the winter storms, as I saw I'm down the beach, and we got hit, pretty heavily there. And I saw the DPW's work there, their commendable work, I might add. And I was prepared to having to deal with, taking it out of the undesignated fund balance, some amount of money to compensate for the unusual amount of weather we had. Because some of you guys know I'm kind of into reading the law, especially the budget law. And I do know that, in there it says that, when you need to do that, you can simply ask the DRA for the okay to take money out of the undesignated fund balance for such expenditures. And I also know that the process, and I have the law in front of me here, and I've reaffirmed my knowledge on that point, the process is that the Board of Selectmen decide they wish to do it, they bring it to the Budget Committee, and then the Budget Committee decides, okay, go ahead and do it. The request is sent to the DRA, and the DRA basically is almost a rubber stamp at that point with both boards approving it. Okay? There is an exception to that process. And that exception is if the money has already been paid and it's a sudden, unexpected emergency to pay it, then you don't have to go to the Budget Committee. Board of Selectmen can race right to the DRA. So what's happening here is that the race is going to the DRA, but the decision was made to pay this money 3 or 4 months after the expense occurred. And it is clear to me that the whole purpose of having paid it first and then asked to go to the DRA, this entire intent of that timing was to cut the Budget Committee out of the approval process. There can be no other explanation for it.
It's interesting. Madam Chair.
Now, as far as the legality of the process and how it's being perverted, beyond that, I have still been in a position of trying to find a way to support this because, again, we did have a lot of expenses relative to snow. But when I look at the formula for the rationale that was used for the number, for example, it's clear everyone has said on the Board of Selectmen, the Town Manager, et cetera, we're going to get some federal funds and reimbursement. Mm-hmm. Now, there's been some dispute in terms of the messages they've given one meeting versus another about how much will be reimbursed. But they know some amount will be reimbursed, at least one day or at least one storm. But as I heard the rationale last night, that number wasn't even calculated in the formula. So just on that basis alone, they're asking for more than the actual cost. This is an opportunity to make more money available to do other things that have nothing to do with the snow. So yeah, I don't like having to take this vote. Thank you very much, Mr. Pierce, for putting it in our lap, but I know you didn't. You're doing the right thing. I appreciate that. And I wish these things were not true. We could just vote, let them do the process. But I can't because of the points that I just made. So I'm going to have to support this motion. And I hope that some of the comments that I've just made, Madam Chair, that you will, if the motion passes, you will include those thoughts to the DRA and why they should deny it. There is ample time for them to come to the Budget Committee with rationale. I am prepared to make an approval for an increase or a reduction from the balance, from the undesignated fund balance. There's time to go through the process. Let's go through the process properly. Let's observe the law. Enough said.
All right, Glenn, you had your hand up, and then Selectman Bean wanted to address us.
I'm not quite sure there has to be that your description of the correct process can still happen.
It can.
Because Mr. Bean has agreed to take this to the selectmen and ask for a breakdown. If we don't get the breakdown, I say we vote.
They instructed the town manager last night to send a letter to the DRA, make the request immediately. So that's already there probably, right, at this moment.
I doubted the DRA.
So we need to get a message to the DRA to please delay or not do it or something.
I'm not sure that they act.
That's what this motion is, to send a letter to DRA. That's all this motion is.
Okay.
As soon as possible.
I don't know if as soon as possible is necessary. I doubt if the DRA does anything that quickly. It's just my guess that they're not going to make a decision.
Well, I don't want to rely on that view.
No.
Okay, I'm going to go to Selectman B.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, Madam Chair. And I just wanted to address, in my initial comments, you and there were some specifics, and of course, we'll get you that through the town manager, a better breakdown on what has actually been paid, who has been paid. Online, on page 11 of 16, I know everyone has read that. Overtime wages for winter are $44,765 over budget. Hired equipment for winter, $321,993 over budget. Salt, $22,757 is an expenditure. That those lines for snow and ice removal alone, according
sounds
to
like
this
we
document,
but we don't know if that is in
and
fact.
I'm just going to finish, please. Are $330,123, and this is from the finance director. So, notwithstanding your request for more information and more drill down and specifics, which is coming, and that email will be copied to you, Madam Chair, the acting town manager, and Chairman Griffin tomorrow morning. And please feel free to be more specific and email me tonight for any exact information you want. But I did want to point the Director Pulliam's subtotal for snow and ice removal alone for this winter is showing a deficit of $330,123.
There it is.
And that's on page 11 of 16 of a report that I know you all read. Thank you.
Do you want to look at May's?
I'm going to give everybody a few minutes to go to 16 and reflect on it.
To go to what?
Ignore the back. It's recycled paper.
No, as a matter of fact, I'm going to take this opportunity to take a 10-minute break.
Excellent idea. Oh,
Madam Chair.
Very good.
Oh.
Thank you, everyone. We are back.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
I'm wondering if I can offer an amendment or ask the makers of the motion to amend the motion. With some of the information that Mr. Jones shared with us and understanding the process a little bit more clearly now, it would seem to me that rather than asking that the request from the selectmen be denied without us having all the information that I think we need, I think that maybe what would be better served for everyone here is that we ask, number one, we ask the selectmen or the acting town manager, if the request has not been filed yet, that they hold off on filing the request until such time they meet with us, or if the request has been filed, then we send the letter asking that they hold off on making a decision until such time as the selectmen can come and meet with us. And if we don't have that meeting, or you know, we get a chance to have it explained to us clearly on what that number is and why they need it, then we can take further action in sending a subsequent letter. But I think this gives both the Board of Selectmen and this board a chance to collaborate on this information. So I think it would be...
I'll second that amendment. I think that it offers an opportunity for more of a collaboration between boards and less of an adversarial position, which is what I think the intent is. So I very much endorse that and second that amendment.
I don't know you can offer an amendment on a motion that hasn't been acted upon.
Yes, you can.
Yes, sure.
It's the only time you can do it.
It's the only time. You're right.
I mean, Mike made a motion, I seconded it, we had our discussion, and now you're making an amendment.
Correct.
Does Mike agree with the amendment?
That's what he has to do.
We're going to vote on the amendment, and then we'll vote on the motion.
Right.
Whether it's amended or not.
That's the process.
So you know, you're going to vote on the amendment before you vote on the primary motion?
That's correct.
Yes, and then if the amendment fails, then you're back to the original motion.
Yep.
Boy, you guys are good.
And I'd have to reword the motion.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think there's still there's a workable avenue in...
I think sending to the DRA to hold off is probably a good idea, right away, because you don't know how long the rest of this will take internally.
Mm-hmm.
I have no problem with that part. The second part is a little more difficult for me to handle in view of some circumstances, but I'm willing to be flexible on the... Writing a letter to the DRA, I can actually just change... Well, I can't change the motion, can I? Without withdrawing the motion. Why don't I do this?
Well, we could ask for universal consent to table the amendment and the motion in preparation of listening to your new motion. How's that?
Want to do that?
No.
No.
If we're going to the same end, mean...
I could withdraw the motion and then make substitute with that remark included.
Or we could simply ask you to restate your motion.
Yeah.
Want to restate the motion with that amendment and see if that meets...
Well, no, you have to do the amendment first.
Wait a minute. You have the motion. There's an amendment to the motion. The amendment to the motion has to be voted on first, or the amendment needs to be withdrawn.
Mm-hmm.
In which case, then it goes back to the motion. Have I got this right?
Yeah.
No, if the motion is withdrawn, then the amendment disappears with it.
Right.
Does it? Okay.
Yeah, it'll go back to zero.
All right. So are you going to withdraw the original motion?
I'll withdraw that, and with the idea that I'll substitute with this DRA delay thing.
Okay. So you have withdrawn your motion, mm-hmm. and now you want the floor to make a new motion.
Either that or I can.
The second has to also withdraw.
No, it's not true.
No.
I withdraw, yeah.
Okay, so you're going to make a new motion? Go ahead.
Why don't we hear this amended motion again?
I'm going to make a new motion.
Right. New motion.
I'll make a motion that we contact the DRA and ask them to postpone the decision on the $352,000 request to be withdrawn from the undesignated fund balance until the Budget Committee and the Selectmen have more of an opportunity to work through the details. And... at that point, then a decision could be made. I don't know how to phrase that at the
end. I'll second that. That sounds fine to me.
Well, let's see the wording on this.
Get the wording down correctly. Somebody help me with that.
That's all. It's just polishing, Mike, a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so the contract...
I think the polishing point was essentially that you wanted to ask the selectmen whether they've sent, or the town manager, whichever the case may be, whether the request of the DRA has been sent by them yet. If the answer is yes, then we need to send a response to the DRA asking them to delay the decision until the Budget Committee has a chance to collaborate with the Board of Selectmen. If the answer is no, then we simply request that the Board of Selectmen collaborate with us on that request prior to sending it to the DRA. All right, that was your intent?
So you're asking the DRA to postpone?
Right, if the request has been made already.
I think the motion...
And in either case, we're asking both.
Yeah.
We're asking the selectmen to postpone, and we're asking DRA to postpone.
I think you want to do that, yes. I think you want to ask everybody.
In both cases, we're asking for collaboration on the process.
Right. Trust but verify.
Can I toss this on the table? Really, what we're talking about is we want the money to go back into the reserve. And if you get federal money back for the storm, that should go into the reserve. That's really all we're talking about.
Well, I think that's one part of it.
Yeah.
Essentially, but it's a big piece.
Yeah.
All right. So we are going to first ask the selectmen if they have already sent it.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this is a two-part piece.
If they've already sent it, then we have to also notify DRA that they should delay any decision on that point until such time that we have the opportunity to collaborate with the selectmen.
Okay.
On the decision of the amount and the itemization and the rationale associated with the decision.
Okay, I think there needs to be some wording in there.
Yeah.
We're going to, and this is a big piece together.
Yeah.
In one part, we are going to ask the Board of Selectmen if they have already forwarded this
or the town manager,
to the 300, the request, all right?
Yeah.
To DRA.
Right.
All right? They may turn around and say, no, we haven't, but we're going to, and we're not going to meet with you. So that has to be coupled with a request.
In that case, you'll be sending the request to the DRA to delay the decision until such time.
But I want to put that wording in here.
Let's simplify it. Notify the selectmen and the DRA to postpone the decision until more facts are known to both parties.
Yeah, but DRA doesn't know anything at this point in time if they haven't submitted it, Mike.
I mean, why do you want to send a flag
up to DRA? Don't even bring them in the water. If they,
right.
if they haven't been notified, keep them out of the picture.
That's why the first contact point is with the Board of Selectmen right. slash town mm-hmm. manager.
Right.
Otherwise,
to get
we're
the answer to whether
it's
been sent or not.
We're willing to work with the Board of Selectmen.
And the town manager.
And the town manager. It's not,
right.
just not carte blanche. There's some things in here
right.
that really need to be discussed
right.
before we take that money out of that account.
Before we make a decision.
Right. And I use we plural, okay?
Yeah. Right.
But
we're not doing any of
you
that.
You might not get the answers to your questions until after the DRA already makes its decision. So
well, that's why she's going to immediately contact the DRA mm-hmm. if the request has been made and tell them
tomorrow
or ask them. Right, tomorrow,
soon.
Right? Yeah, tomorrow.
Well, I think time being of the essence.
Can we
that
get
wording
that
being used?
Information,
that we should put a deadline by, you know, noon tomorrow. Has this gone forward or hasn't it?
Right. If she gets an affirmative answer that the request has been sent, or if she gets no answer by noon tomorrow, then she will send a communication to DRA indicating our desire to have that decision to be put on hold until further communication.
I think we need to ask Mr. Bean, Selectman Bean, is that doable? We can
well, if I may, Madam Chair.
Certainly.
You know, again, I just go to 11 of 16 on the director's report. Additionally, there's for paving and reconstruction, that's $128,000 in the hole. Some of that is clearly to mitigate storm damage and potholes. So the board voted 4-1 last evening in accordance with RSAs that govern our responsibilities as selectmen for the prudential affairs. A vote was taken. That is now in the execution phase, and it would be my understanding that that is the position of the town and that the town manager will execute as he was instructed to by that 4-1 vote last night. And that would be my position. I would vote against any motion otherwise, or else I'm speaking out of two sides of my face. And I say this respectfully to all the discussion.
You'd
that
be well,
fine, if
you're
I
on
may
board.
exactly. So
if I'm
just saying, and that would be my position. And then that your board and your board members would vote however you would vote. I'm one member, but it was a 4-1 vote last night.
So you were given this report. Now, clearly, I just roughly added up numbers and what you pointed out before pointing this out. And that was at about $372,000, give or take. And so now you're saying that this overage in the roads and the problems there is another additional $100,000.
Well, I'm looking at fourth line 4312. That is out and in the negative $128,096.
Right.
Certainly, that some of that is to mitigate storm damage and those tremendous potholes that occurred.
Right. I'm already over the number that was requested. Was aside from the report that you're pointing out
yes,
to
ma'am.
Us, and thank you for doing that because you bring us right to the spots that we need to look at. Aside from that, were you actually given a list? Because I remember hearing like 352,000 blah 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 and like 18 cents, which was a very
it was
finite.
It was $241.
I'm sorry?
352,241.
Okay.
And 10
That's
cents.
A very finite number,
yeah.
All right, that came from specific things. And going through this in the report, while I can get in the ballpark range and say, oh, yeah, here's 200,000 and here's 100,000, it still doesn't come to that number. Were you actually given a list?
We may have been. I did not read that
okay.
specifically. We, you know, I do miss some of my reading materials
mm-hmm.
From time to time, but I have confidence in the town manager.
Yes, we all have trust in one another, but I'm saying,
and he did
for
explain.
This amount of money to take it out of
he did explain his mathematics. I do know that I did read his data at some point in the last week or two. but I can't recall specifically the document or the title, but he did do it. He did explain his process. He did explain the comparison and contrast between good snow years, if there is one, and bad snow years.
And he did explain the process. I listened carefully. I subsequently recorded it and listed it again. Okay. And he did not include the federal funds for the emergency.
On the one storm.
On the one storm, the one day, the 2 day, whatever it happens to be. It's clear we all agree that we're going to get some funding from the feds on this snow.
Right.
But that was not part of his formula. So his request, by definition, is an overage request, just on that basis alone. And you made a statement about you gave direction to the town manager to make the request to the DRA, and you said it in such a way that suggested to me, and I wanted you to confirm or deny, that are you suggesting that this committee should operate under the assumption that the request to the DRA has already been made? Should we operate with that assumption?
I have no knowledge of that.
Should we? Are you recommending that we operate?
I'm making no recommendation.
Making no recommendation. All right, I want to be clear on that.
Yeah, no.
All right.
Yes.
Just a point of clarification on that. That $128,000 that you called attention to. That's a total of the whole department. So there's positive variances in the cleaning and maintenance, storm drainage, sidewalks, and that's offset in that negative variance of the $330,000. So that department. You know, that 4312 department total is $128,000.
I'm looking at line 4312 on page 11 of 16. It's showing a negative balance of $128,096.
Right, and that's a total of a positive of 160 from the previous page on 10 of 16. Mm-hmm. On the left-hand side there, it's a positive variance of $116,000, positive of 59, positive of 26, negative of 330. So the department total is a negative of $128,000. It's not 330 plus 120.
Yeah. The point just here. Excuse me.
Yeah.
You know, the selectmen have the power, the authority to move money around between all of these mm-hmm. budgets. And if you look through May, Mike happened to give me this one. They're running, you know, spent 36% of the 2015 budget, and they still have a positive variance of $16,675 in total. So looking at the big picture, I don't
see. Found the money somewhere else.
I don't see, and this is with the accrued open POs and everything, including the open POs that money was obviously obligated for. So I don't see at this point in time an out-of-control situation here through April or May. That's why I need to know not only what's been itemized, but how does it figure with the total budget, with respect to the total budget, not just one department or one line item or two and three items, the whole department and then the whole town's budget.
Whole town budget.
So, right. And then what did we get for that first storm, and how does that weigh in to this thing? And if they can reconcile it, and with through analysis and rationale, I'd be the first to vote yes. But right now, I don't have that information.
Tim, and then we got
expenses related to the snowstorms have already been paid.
They have been.
Okay, so there is no emergency need here,
right,
to find money to pay it. Right. It's already been paid.
Yep, we're already obligated. Right. And we have a $16,000 positive variance through May.
Right. So there's no reason to, proclaim an emergency and have the sirens blazing away. We should take the time to look at the rationale of how much is being requested, make sure it is a rational formula that's being used, but we really don't have a sense of rationality in the formula that has been enunciated, if for no other reason than that federal fund reimbursement was not specified in some other questions that are arised as well, other questions as well.
But, I can understand emergencies. You get a broken pipe and it's pumping sewer out into the main street, you got to fix it.
Right.
And
right.
The town manager's got the power to go fix it and spend the money.
Right.
Or if a bridge is blown out, we got to fix that bridge right now.
Right.
Okay.
But you don't proclaim an emergency 4 months after you incurred the expense.
And you don't. And that, in this case here, you may bring in a budget committee for some collaboration, but really the town manager's got the power.
The only thing I want to add to that is that in the beginning, this emergency happened at the beginning of our budget. so there is no emergency that's going to drain the budget to the $226 million in February. This, I'm sure, has a little bit of forecasting for the down the road of expenses that will come on board. My biggest problem with it is that I felt it was a little bit premature, and it's putting money that possibly will come back to us from the federal government into the budget and not into the reserves. So the and that's my problem with it. But, you know, yeah, you could pay the bills out of $26 million for what happened here back in February. So that's not my biggest issue with it.
So it's a forecasted emergency, you could argue, I think, is what you're saying, and I think that makes sense. But it's not a present emergency.
Right.
It's a forecasted
That's
one.
Why I'm saying we're a little
we
bit premature on the
We have time to look
act.
At it in calm, deliberative fashion.
Right.
And that needs to occur.
And maybe we should just look at it from a point of view of asking the DRA to postpone any decision.
That's essentially all we've been trying to
That's
do.
All.
But we want to incorporate
collaboration.
A sense of collaboration with the Board of Selectmen. We don't want to do it in a way that gives any sense of adversarial posture.
So what we're offering is cooperation on it and just not jumping the gun, and it doesn't appear that we need to jump that gun in the moment.
Right.
Sure.
The question is DRA?
Yes.
If I may, an examination of the RSA that specifically addresses this request to the DRA. Point of law was raised by Selectman Wolseley last night.
Mm-hmm.
It was explained that that was not the case, but the RSA specifically does, in some instances, refer that it must be approved by both the Board of Selectmen and the Budget Committee. As Mr. Welch related it last night, this particular instance does not require that. I don't think the Board of Selectmen would feel that if the selector or the Budget Committee wrote a letter explaining your rational position that you have tonight in your opinion, I don't think it's adversarial. I think you're an independent board. You do so in performing your duties. Everyone here is an honorable person. You have an opinion. You have a vote. We would ask you to do it, and then the DRA looks at it, and it's kind of a different conversation. The selectmen have their powers. There is the RSA. But I think just because you send a letter, and I would not support that if you vote on that, because I voted last night.
Yeah.
But I don't think that means it's adversarial. I think it's we disagree with that position.
It's an honest
board. Yeah. Yeah.
And would like you to take a look at that. And I don't think that's adversarial.
Thank you.
Thank you.
David.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think what you just said is great, and it would be great if you could share that with your fellow selectmen so that it wouldn't seem like this board and the selectmen were at odds. Mm. But
great idea.
You know, if you said it exactly the way I would have said it. If you could just share it with your peers, that would be great.
Be happy to do that. Thank you. Thanks, Dave. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Okay. Are we ready to take a vote?
I hope so.
I do, too.
I just want to clear what you had. Mike make the motion, and was it Glenn that seconded the motion?
Glenn.
Yes.
All right,
what
thank
was
you.
The motion? Can you repeat it for everyone in the audience?
Oh, no, you don't want me to do that.
Just repeat all discussion once for me.
There you go.
Hit the replay button.
Yeah, exactly. We're going to have to hit the replay button. All right. Did you write that down? I've got it, but I've written it in a square. Okay. It's two parts here. Contacting the Board of Selectmen to find out if the letter has already been sent, and if it has not, we're requesting from them that we meet jointly. If it has already been sent, then I'm going to contact the DRA and request a delay in the approval until the Budget Committee and the Board of Selectmen can meet jointly to collaborate on this issue.
Perfect.
Are we good with that?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Is there anything else?
Well, if you get any vibes that they don't wish the town manager is going to go ahead and he's got orders from the board, and if you get any vibes that they're going to push ahead and issue that letter, then you have to as well.
Just send the letter.
Including if you get no response by noon letter. Tomorrow, send it.
Mm-hmm. We also don't meet for three more months, too.
You know, we're trying to...
Well, we haven't decided that yet.
We're trying to accomplish two things. Protect funds on one hand, and forge a budget year with cooperation between boards and the town manager, because that's how everybody is going to be best served. So if this is an exercise in futility, so be it. We've been open, we've been transparent.
It's not possible to be an exercise in futility.
I think we've worked around the table to a good end. The rest is out of our hands and in someone else's.
It's an exercise in good government, so let's vote on it.
All right, vote on it. All those in favor of the amendment?
Unanimous. Or I don't know, Brian, you didn't...
The motion, you mean?
Motion. Did I, what did I say?
You said amendment, but you meant motion.
I'm sorry, the motion. All right. All those opposed? And abstentions?
I voted against it.
You voted against it?
We got it.
Did you vote, Phil?
Yes, I did.
Good. You voted no, yes?
I voted no.
He's one of three rebels here.
Okay, good work.
Yes.
Exhausting.
No.
But that was honorable discussion, though.
It was.
Good government discussion, actually. I would set the stage for the rest of the budget year.
Well, I hope so.
Well, it was an important issue, and it was worth the time, so...
I think I'd like to wipe out numbers 10 to 13 and just go, no. That was good work, gentlemen. Thank you very much. That's what happens when everybody participates. It's a good thing. Moving on to 10 and old business. Anybody have anything that they want to throw in tonight for old business? They don't dare. You don't dare, do you?
No, I don't.
Jerry?
Brian, did you have one?
I did have one thing.
Go ahead.
Well, it's not so much, well, it's old business, because it already happened. But I just wanted to make a comment about the Hampton Beach Commission had a meeting the other night. It was in the paper. It was really well represented. There was just about someone there from every committee about transportation.
Oh, yeah.
What works out, getting to the, not just to the beach, but the town, changing the island around. It was down here.
I saw that.
And I just want to commend them, because it was really a good meeting.
Very nice.
And we had the state reps, selectmen, I was there. We separated into the three groups, and there was a lot of common ground.
Were there any budget implications to that meeting?
Excuse me?
Were there any budget implications on that meeting?
No.
Okay, good.
But
next.
There will become some coming.
It's going to materialize. You got another meeting, I guess, in the fall.
In the fall.
Yeah.
But I just wanted to say that it was
very good.
Really,
I saw you there.
Brian, you've done a good job of keeping a pulse on that. If you see anything in those meetings that have a budget implication, if you would let us know ahead of time, and then
it would be appreciated. Yeah.
That would be a good thing. All right, moving out of old business.
I have one other, Eileen, on old business, if you
want. Okay, go ahead.
I just want to reiterate, you know, last year was very trying when it came to budgeting.
It did.
And I thought you were going to ask the town manager, Christy, to come in so we could talk a little bit about the mechanics of the budgets and how, you know, we got the default column, and we want to stress the backup information should be adequate and thorough, so that if there's any increase in a particular line item, it's self-explanatory. And we want to talk about things like that. Mm-hmm. So we don't have a repeat of the grueling exercise, necessarily, that we went through last year. And if we don't lay down some mechanics, they're in the budgeting session right now. Already, in June, they're beginning their budget preparations for, you know, starting submission in September. So we've got to get some mechanics in place, I think. And, get an agreement as to make sure they understand, they being Fred and Christy, what we are looking for.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
you do know we are getting the column in the books with
for
the default budget.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's
it.
A
won't
big
be
thing.
A separate printing
right
this year. It will be in the book.
But I mean, you know, last year we asked from day one on the gas and oil, from day one, and we never got the kind of an answer we wanted until the very last day of the budget committee meeting, when we said we have to reduce it because gas is now selling for whatever it was, $1.85 or $1.90,
yeah,
and we were paying $3.50 a year ago or whatever it was. So this is not right. We've got to try to work collaboratively again, and the only way we can do that is be open and honest about what we think the shortcomings are and how we can improve them. If that doesn't happen, we're going to have to go through this again with the whole question.
Hopefully it won't. Hopefully tonight will open a different door.
So
but I agree with you.
You know, And what's our philosophy going to be? Are we asking them to hold a flat budget and go to warrant articles on anything that may be capital?
I want to talk about a little bit about new business without being here for another hour.
Yeah.
So, you mind if I move on to new business?
I invite it.
Okay. Actually, one little wrap-up on old business, because we have a couple of people here tonight that we put on committees. Here's another area that I think has gotten a life and is totally misunderstood. We have formed subcommittees if we need them. If these meetings at night that we have, there's 15 of us, there was only so much time to go over a topic. In the past, when we formed subcommittees, we could meet, talk about it a little bit more. People have taken this to mean that we are going to march into everybody's office and micromanage the town, and that is not the case whatsoever. If anything, it is to help and is to reduce the time that we spend here when we do finally bring the departments in. So I think this has been the redheaded stepchild that is woefully misunderstood. All right? At the last, well, it wasn't the last meeting, it was the meeting before that.
Yeah,
there were a couple of you that, I don't think you were sworn in yet, you weren't here, Jim, and you left early, and we put you on committees, but that's not fair, okay, or subcommittees.
You didn't put me on any committees. I watched it. I was not put on any committees.
Yeah, we did. You have to really listen. We did.
I did. I listened to it several times.
Suck you in. I'll find the point for you.
I even have a copy on YouTube for you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, we snuck you in, Stephen did, on the Rules and Guidelines Committee.
No.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, you remember it.
I remember it.
See, but...
No, he suggested it.
Yeah.
Oh.
And said, of course, you'll have to ask Tim, to quote him.
Well, that's what I'm doing.
And my answer is, no, thank you. I appreciate the thought.
So that's it. On the list, cross out Tim Jones on that committee. And let's see, Jim, I think we did you at one of those wonderful services too, where we thought you would be good on the administrative committee with Scott and Mike.
What's the intent of that committee?
It has no intent right now, but it would cover...
If we're not going to meet, then I'm all for it, yeah.
Let me tell you, this is how it would work. All of us in this room have busy lives, okay? We cannot focus on absolutely everything that's contained in almost 1,000 lines of budget. When you break it down into subcommittees, everything that comes under the administration, if your ears perk up, and you've been an official before in another town, Mike has been a selectman, perfect candidates. It's a good place for Scott to get wet in this arena, because he'll be here down the road, possibly. To follow along those things in administration. The insurances is one place. Mm. You know, I try to keep up with all of it, but I do a lousy job of it. So I'm like, where are we with the insurance? Is it up? Is it down? When do we... Those types of things, as far as the sub... You're not... Like, this is where I say we're misunderstood. It's not like you're going to go in and tell them what the insurance rates are going to be. But by you reporting back to us periodically, hey, this is where we are in the insurance, we might want to delay a vote on that or whatever, it's the best example that I can give you of a
that's
subcommittee
fine.
In
yeah,
action.
That's fine.
Okay, Tim?
I'd like to speak about this in committees in general as well.
All right, so can I...
Think of the administration committee like you would think of the DPW committee. DPW committee focuses on DPW matters. The administration committee is supposed to be focusing on, not the administration of the budget committee, but
personnel.
But the administration of the town, mm-hmm. right, that side of the...
I understand what administration is. I didn't know if we would be charged
as far as
with a particular... but if we're not, that's fine.
And I think that's part of the issue that I want to speak to now, which is really a problem we have with
the town.
It's a problem we have with all of the committees that I wanted to speak to now. Which is that we've gotten so far, and hopefully that might change, but we've got a clear message from Phil a couple months ago about protocol, which included there'll be no accounting visibility. And of course, all these committees, subcommittees, are intended to be a vehicle by which accounting visibility can be realized. But if there'll be no accounting visibilities, and that statement was endorsed by his Board of Selectmen, if that is their continuing posture, then our committees, it seems to me, would be reduced to not getting any answers to questions or any facts, but merely making the questions we have more cogent and coherent. And beyond that, those committees wouldn't have much of a function at all. So I think that's where we stand with the committees. It's really limited to just basically, you know, assembling questions and making them coherent and cogent.
Or it could be the way we did it last year when we, Eileen asked for people to email their questions. Mm-hmm. Maybe that committee goes over.
Well, right. They'd be quite honestly,
all of the department heads came back and they didn't start out that way, but in the end they came back and they said they really liked that process of the written questions before they came in, which gave them the opportunity to come in with an answer. So I guess the bottom line is that the subcommittees are not meant to be adversarial. They're meant to be helpful in gathering information so that we don't have meetings that go to 12 o'clock again this year.
That's absolutely true, but the unfortunate side of it is that the elements that we need to work with in a cooperative, congenial fashion have decided to interpret it quite the opposite.
Well,
until such time as we get an indication that they have a different view of the matter, I think these committees are unnecessary overhead for us because they're not going to produce any real value added in that environment.
With all due respect,
speaking of
I hear you, but I don't agree with you.
There you go. I think, who's on it with me, Scott?
Yeah.
And who else? You?
You're
I think
good.
We'll be fine. I think we'll get all the cooperation we need.
Selectman Bean had his hand up.
Yeah, I just wanted to, and I'm having a hard time putting together the pieces of the discussion, but the formal lines of communication enhances transparency, enhances information flow, lets everybody know, certainly via email, what information requests are.
We do not email.
Who doesn't email?
We don't email. We email information one way, consolidated only. We do not email on this committee back and forth to one another.
Oh, okay. So, but the information
That's
request
the
information request would come from you as the chair.
Right. I was going to do the part two of this.
Yeah, of lines of communication. But I want to respond in terms of accounting or any information. Fuel, as Jerry has asked about, is those requisites for information are channeled from you. Mm-hmm. They come to me. They go to Fred Welch. They go to the chairman of the selectmen. And then it goes to that department, and Fred is the town manager, Mr. Welch. And
see,
then those information requests go to you,
I
and they go to you in
a timely
manner.
I think where some of that fell apart. Excuse me a minute.
The problem that I had was, you're, and I believe I'm quoting you, and you said there'll be no accounting visibility in your speech that you made.
Well, that's you're not quoting me correctly.
No, it's not.
Well, I'll call it up. I'll call it up and get right back to you then.
Okay. Let me throw something into this, all right?
You don't need to listen to it until I find the exact spot.
At our last meeting, we went through a little mini course on the authority of the Budget Committee as it exists. And the bottom line is that we can ask and request from anyone. What has happened here is a dynamic where now instead of going right to a department head, which I never had any problem with, I now have to go through half a dozen people to get the answer. That's not efficient as far as I'm concerned. I have never been abrasive to any department head in 15 years in this community. So to some extent, to have to jump through all those hoops, my time's valuable too, and wait for that to all come back where I had direct access and have direct access through the statutes seemed not really to have a purpose other than to create an adversarial position. But being a big girl and wanting government to work, all right, I can put my ego and all of that aside and say I have, as the chairman on this committee, no problem working with my committee in a way that the information can go through its course, provided, and there is a proviso in there, that I get the response that I need back. Otherwise, this committee will do whatever it has to do to pass the budget, or to recommend, I shouldn't say pass the budget, the voters pass the budget, to recommend a budget to the voters. So that being said, I would appreciate nobody going rogue, but then again, we never have. If you go through the minutes of at least two meetings that we've had this year and every other year, we never have gone rogue. everything has gone through the chair as far as appointments, formal appointments, and formal requests, as did the notes that we sent last year, Jerry remembers. That went through the chair. Jerry did not just take, or anybody else who sent questions, did not take it upon themselves to just send that out to a department head. So we're just going to continue doing as we have been doing, with nothing new, with due respect to all the people that work for us in this town, because their time is valuable. But not only is their time valuable, and we pay them very well in this town, but our time is valuable, and we don't get paid anything. Okay, so I do think that there has to be a little bit of a new dawning of cooperation and realize that, you know what, if I want to know how much a pencil is, I shouldn't have to go through 16 people.
I think we just throw a little stone in the water. In other words,
yeah.
If I would like to go to the wastewater treatment plant, mm-hmm. and meet the fellows there for a couple of hours.
Then you'll go.
I'll make sure you would like that. I make you aware of that. You will go, from what I understand, Phil, at the meeting through Rick. Would she then contact Rick, or would she go to the town manager?
The lines of communication, as we've discussed, have been approved by the selectmen.
Yes.
And is that the request comes from the chair.
To
there's 12 members. It goes, I'm the liaison. It goes to Fred Welch in the chair. And it goes from there. And yeah. I think that enhances communication.
Yeah.
There isn't a corporation in the world where you can call up the president of some company. Or
right,
head.
Right.
I've got a claim in my auto and I want to speak to the president of Liberty.
Right. So, I mean, let's just
remember, like I said, I have no problem with functioning that way. Just remember, the RSAs tell us if I want to skip through A, B, C, and D and go right to the next guy, that we have the ability to do it. But I have no problem creating a chain. Just realize we are an autonomous board.
It has to be timely.
Well, Madam Chair.
Yes.
I fail to understand, Phil, your presentation a couple months ago. Because your board, when you went and reported back to them, all of you, including yourself, we're advancing what you said as nothing more than standard operating procedure, expressing surprise that anyone would be upset by it. And so why is it such a big deal that suddenly things have to be changed? If we were operating under standard operating procedure and doing nothing more than we've always done, then how is it that the assessor who was scheduled for our meeting suddenly got cut out? Obviously, there's been a change to that process. And there's been some adversarial words coming from your board relative to this committee for some period of time. And that is the point of confusion that's occurring here.
Just point of order.
Point of order. I have the floor here.
He has the floor.
Okay, I have the floor. I'm not going down this road.
So the point here is that is, I believe, where the source of confusion is. On one hand, you and your board are saying it's just standard operating procedure. We've always done it that way. And yet, every time we try to do what we've always done the same way, it's immediately criticized, even villainized. And so we feel as though there is a difficulty in finding a spot to be cooperative.
Tim.
Okay.
Tim.
And, well, okay.
There's been some
I feel okay. there is a difficulty in finding a spot to be cooperative, and I think others on the committee share that view. Now, Chairman Latimer has made a clear, legally correct statement that she can go directly to anybody in town and get information. And by law, they're duty bound. And there's another law, as you well know, or maybe you don't, that actually if they don't respond to their duties under law, they are subject to criminal punishment. All right, so there's real teeth behind that, what she's saying. But there's another RSA, and it's called 91A, the right to know law. And we're all citizens here. And each of us can individually invoke that law to get our answers as well. So that protocol is not absolute, but we're willing to try to conform to it in the spirit of trying to achieve cooperation. But we're not chained and bound to it.
I guess what I'm trying to say is that we will try to function in a way that will alleviate the stress that we're feeling between these two committees. However, I do not want that to be confused as a directive from the selectmen to this committee, but better as a cooperation, because there will be committees that go forward, and the RSAs dictate what we can do. So I guess this is the olive branch to say, let's try to work together until we don't get results, or we do. All
right. Yes, let us continue to try.
I think, and I asked to be recognized.
I already acknowledged, and then I'll go back to you. Okay.
I thought the presentation, you know, the last meeting was very informative.
Yes.
And he related some experiences that he had in Bow that seemed to be successful. And I, you know, you have the department heads that are preparing budgets who are then to the town manager. The town manager's putting it to the selectmen. The selectmen send it to us.
Mm-hmm.
And we're also querying the department heads. And it just seems that if we could have the selectmen and this committee around the same table and we jointly talk to the department heads, that to me makes all the sense in the world.
Well, people,
and so it, versus the subcommittees, I mean, I think that
you know, Scott is
that was
we
a,
do
it was a that great happens. Recommendation. The only problem is that I looked into the budget of Bow, which is minuscule compared to the budget of Hampton.
Yeah.
And that piece in itself, I know he suggests, he said they got together on a few Saturdays and yeah. they ironed out the whole budget all together, and boy, wouldn't that be wonderful. That's like going to Disneyland.
This is something we could try in four Saturdays.
But, you know, as an open conversation, maybe if I make an appointment with the Board of Selectmen, perhaps as a step into the future, maybe we could try it with a few departments.
Yeah, that would be
those
good.
Three departments that make up 76% of our budget.
Police,
well, as a pilot program, we could try it with one department. You know, and the real value here is the saving of time is not the budget committee.
Yeah.
It's the department heads.
Yes.
They'll only
yes.
have to go to one meeting.
Yeah.
All right? And that is good for everybody.
So as a consensus, would this board be open to that?
Let's try a pilot.
Trying
on one
a pilot.
One department.
Animal control.
Well, that's not a department.
Just throwing it out.
I think there's danger in that with 15 of us and
17 people in a meeting.
You know, you get.
I think it's going to be chaos.
You got five. I mean, you're going to have 18 to 20 people.
We're huge. We're huge. How
yeah, but
we
if
have
we,
to
if
get
we
a
do it on
out?
A Saturday.
You know, we all have our emotions and blend it in there. Oh, God.
Jerry, you got enough of 10 of us. But
yeah, and everybody starts talking, right?
Yeah. Well, I mean, all right.
I don't envision that as being successful. To have everybody,
it wasn't a motion, it was just...
No, that's why I said throw it out there and see. It's
perhaps a subcommittee of the budget committee could attend with the Board of Selectmen.
Well, that might be very good.
Well, then you're still going to force the other person to come in here.
Well, we won't necessarily. The whole committee might decide that was sufficient and we don't need them to come in. That would be the intent.
This can go on.
Well, if the subcommittee is representative of our committee, then that might be appropriate. But you know what? Maybe we can open up dialogue. We're not quite into budget yet.
Yeah.
So
it would be useful, Phil, if the Board of Selectmen, you know, had gave us some sense of whether it would be you know something they'd be willing to consider.
Yeah, and I just think, and if I may, Madam Chair, there's a huge spirit of cooperation from everybody in this town, and you're a sovereign board, and the lines of communication are designed to foster that timely information requests from your board to help you make better decisions, and by doing so, the selectmen also gain situational awareness and focus on those issues. So I don't see anything as adversarial between these boards. By RSAs, they're ruled by state law, and by honorable and hardworking people that have other things to do in their lives, as you have said. So information requests as your board liaison to the selectmen. I'm keenly interested when you as the chairman of the budget committee for the town of Hampton have information requests that they're met in an expeditious, timely fashion. Period.
Yeah.
Thank you. All right. Moving on.
No.
Huh?
I guess that was no to my question. I don't know.
Well, I like this.
All right.
Is that it?
I passed out. We're still a new business, and we're going to wrap this up.
Thank you.
I passed out a calendar.
Yeah.
For everybody.
Yeah. Yep. Thank you.
Every time I pass out a calendar, by the time I get to the end of the week, somebody's called me and informed me that
this
I can't.
This is the.
I have to change it.
Schedule for this.
This is the schedule for the rest of our budget term.
Oh, okay. This includes
everything.
When various budgeteers are coming in.
Right. Budgeteers.
I thought we took summers off.
The three budgeteers?
Jerry, but that's what I'm qualifying. This is my version of life.
Okay.
Right.
It may be changed.
Yeah, well, Fred should get, somebody, Fred or Phil should get a copy and mark it up if this is going to change.
But I think I probably actually made it easier for other people.
Yeah. I believe at that meeting.
Did you have a copy of this?
Where you were discussing the committees, you did suggest the possibility that the July and August dates might be used as a kind of a collective committee meeting date, which sounded like kind of an interesting idea.
So they are out there. Our July and our August meetings are out there collectively. We started the night saying, where are we going to meet in July and August? And so I'm ending the night asking the same question. Do we need to meet in July and August? Can we meet in July and August? Can we have those meeting nights maybe as joint nights with the Board of Selectmen if that's where we want to go? What's your feeling?
Given the situation with the DRA and the possibility we may need to meet on that question.
Yeah, so I'd say July meeting is on.
Yes.
Yeah. And I think, you know, we can address August at that point as well.
I suggest we don't have any meetings until September.
Well, we're going to do in response to the DRA situation.
Based on your
We haven't got a response back, and it'll probably be too late anyway. So don't count your chickens until they hatch.
Well, you're the one counting your chickens before they hatch because you used the word probably. I'm saying it's possible, so we should schedule for the possibility.
Right. So
if we schedule but cancel?
Right.
Yeah. How about if we schedule only for that?
I would like to have 1 month off this year.
Right.
I think with the motion that we made, we're kind of locked into July, unless miraculously it hasn't been sent and the Board of Selectmen will agree to postpone until we all meet. But I then think that we either have to meet with them on one of their nights, which their schedule's pretty full.
Or Saturday.
Or we have to meet here. No, we're not meeting on Saturdays. We have to meet. We should be here at our next meeting. So, or date has to be established. So we'll leave July. We'll leave August on the calendar, too, but look at August as probably a no-go.
Okay.
I would recommend that we vote on August at the July meeting.
I agree with you.
Informed at that
All
point.
Right.
Regarding the DRA situation, we'll have much more information on that.
Yeah.
We make that call in July.
That's right. I agree.
Nick hasn't said much tonight. But
good
I
idea, Nick.
I got one every
Which
now.
I thought of it.
Okay. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
I'll make that motion.
All right. In a second?
Second.
9:25.
What about the secretary?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, secretary.